6th edition of the Planning Commission for the City of Sammamish. Check with the commission members, make sure everyone's got their microphone on. And I'll start with roll call on my right, please.
Cynthia Crass.
Frank Blau.
Ryan Holman.
Philip Cherian.
Mabubul Islam.
Mike Collins.
Mike Lexenberg is not here tonight, but he has been excused. And before we get through the agenda, I do just want to make one note. We will have our regular public comment period before we get into our matters, the two items for tonight. Non-agenda public comment, 3 minutes each. We will have a public comment period after comprehensive plan, the transportation work session. For tonight's tree retention issue, it is a kind of information gathering piece for the commission tonight, so we will not be taking public comment tonight. We will take public comment after future meetings, and then the commission will also hold a public hearing in the future. So we do invite you to provide us with any written comment in advance if you would like. We will definitely take that and read it and think about it. But as I said, tonight's kind of a fact gathering, and everyone's here to just kind of get their basis. So with that, is there a motion to approve the agenda?
I move to approve the agenda and the minutes.
Second.
Can we do that?
Yes.
Okay, motion to approve the agenda and the minutes all at once. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The agenda for tonight and the minutes for October 16th are approved. And that brings us to our first public comment period for anything that's not on our agenda for this evening. Words of wisdom, joke of the day, anything somebody wants to just kind of bring generally to the commission's attention.
Ratings of Seahawks.
Sure. Oh, I don't. Debbie, is there Emily sign up sheet? In the meantime, if there is anybody that just wants to provide us with anything. Podium's over there. 3 minutes.
No,
so technically, tree retention for public comment is not on the agenda. So tree retention is not an agenda item for public comment.
Well, tree retention.
So it would be general comment then.
Tree retention is on our agenda.
Not for public comment.
Not for public comment, correct. And we will take transportation public comments next.
And there's non-agenda public comment. No one
okay.
wishes to make comment.
All right. Well, seeing none for general public comment, I will close that period, and we will move to our comprehensive plan old business.
Great. Good evening, Commission. This is Emily Arteche. I'm your project manager for the city's comprehensive plan. And today, we're going to have our policy discussion on the transportation element. We have Victor Salomon back here to lead you through the discussion. He's also put in your packets a memo for you to read, which accompanies the PowerPoint presentation. I'll be up at the front taking notes on your tracking sheet and putting any parking lot issues down for you. But without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Victor for his presentation.
Thank you. Good evening, commissioners. Is this working? All right, so a little bit of a recap in terms of where we are working on the transportation element. Some trends in Sammamish. Again, traffic volumes are continuing to increase, but also filling up the system that's out there. So as one route becomes more congested, traffic will tend to use another route that may actually be longer, but less congested and maybe shorter in time, which is actually considered a good thing. That's one that we call it transportation system management. It's kind of using all the system that's available so we aren't continually widening the same routes, but taking advantage of excess capacity in other places. Transit service recently has been at risk due to funding shortfalls. The City of Seattle, you may have noticed, did approve their transit funding package, $60 car tab, and I think a 0.5% sales tax increase, Jeff, for them to supplement King County Metro to provide and maintain existing levels of service and expand them in the city. And that's something other agencies may begin to do in order to maintain that service. Locally, more interest in non-motorized active transportation. The city's getting more requests for sidewalk and bicycle projects, and those projects are primarily in the neighborhoods, not on the major arterials, but on those streets that really have no facility for bicycles and pedestrians. And then the new town center plan that was adopted since the original comprehensive plan is designed to support non-motorized travel, designed to have a function we call internal capture, where trips stay there. You maybe park once, do multiple things in the same area, potentially even live and work in a walkable community. Some regional emerging issues since 2003, the first plan. There's still a state law in terms of the state and local agencies working to reduce vehicle miles of travel per capita. There were some goals in 2008 that they aren't gone yet, in terms of implementing policy to get everyone to drive a little less. So not stop driving, but reduce that total amount of travel, make your trips shorter or take fewer of them. Green infrastructure challenges. This was from a couple years ago on the PSRC website. Not as big a challenge anymore. I think the infrastructure has been pretty well established. It's just the range of some of the electric cars and how we charge them for longer trips. Changes in vehicle ownership and driving habits. We talked about last time that generally per capita vehicle ownership is declining. So in the long, 20-year forecast, generally fewer people are going to own cars or fewer cars per person. And then again, we've seen shifts to non-motorized and active transportation. Primarily, those non-motorized trips are connecting to transit. That's where the big increase is. So it's not that you're walking 20 miles to work, but more people are walking a half a mile to a transit stop and then taking the bus. So non-motorized trips you should consider are usually part of a chain trip that involves some other modes. So maybe there's a walk trip or a bike trip, then a transit trip, then another walk or bike trip. They're seldom just a pure walk trip. And then we see that increased demand for transit being driven both by congestion, the challenge of driving a single occupancy vehicle, but also being driven by social values in terms of not wanting to be part of that problem or not wanting to be part of climate change. So a lot of people are choosing transit, even though it's less convenient than a car, they're choosing it for other reasons. So the planning framework in terms of some things we have to do. So the Washington Growth Management Act, which I know you are well familiar with, requires us to do a transportation element. We need to be consistent with the Puget Sound Regional Council and multi-county planning policies that we'll be covering a lot in this presentation. And then so the city of Sammamish specifically, the things that affect you locally are your level of service standards, your public work standards, your capital facility plan, which is the long range plan, a transportation improvement plan, which is another state required plan that deals with the 6-year window, and then how we pay for all those facilities. And the transportation element of the compound elements really has the kind of most stringent requirements for having a balanced capital plan with a funding plan. You really should be balancing the books. So again, the Growth Management Act requirements, having a level of service standard, which the city has actually a very comprehensive and much more multimodal than most other cities in the area. We need to do a forecast of traffic for at least 10 years. The city has a travel demand model that's being used to forecast a 20-year forecast out to 2035. A new element since 2003 is the pedestrian and bicycle component, and we'll need, it's one of the issues on the tracking sheet, is how we integrate some older planning work on the non-motorized side that's not quite the same as non-motorized transportation in the context of a transportation element, but has some value as well. And then another new element, a description of existing and planned transportation demand management strategies, and we'll talk a little bit about what those might look like. And then kind of re-looking and reassessing the future funding capability. So the multi-county planning policies really focus on three key areas, providing mobility, supporting growth, and operating the system in a sustainable way, and getting the most out of it effectively. So a little more detail. Again, a focus on now providing a lot more choice in terms of travel, so that mobility is not just getting in your car and driving the speed limit anytime you want, anywhere you want, but it's recognizing that may not be affordable or possible all the time, and there should be options. You should be able to walk reasonably. You should be able to either walk to the service or the potentially your job, if you possibly could, or especially, though, to transit. So that's a key thing. If you want, there's been a lot of community interest in transit and a lot of community interest in pedestrian and bicycle. I'm not sure if the thought was, I want to be able to walk to a transit stop, but if you can't, then transit starts losing its effectiveness. Once a commuter gets into the car, it's tough to get them out again to go into the bus. So as you think about goals and policies, connecting transit with non-motorized uses tends to get us a lot more transportation choices than a 5-mile path would that goes from one end of the city to the other but doesn't go near a transit stop.
The opposite is also true. To improve or to raise density during your by your transit facilities accomplishes that also.
Correct. Yep. More people closer to transit. Yeah. Has the again the facility needs to be there for them to feel safe while they're walking. We'll talk a little bit about that, kind of a security element to non-motorized transportation. And then clearly a key goal is supporting growth. So the transportation facilities should be supporting the growth that you want and where you want it. And then the system operations, which is a very broad term, and it's on the tracking sheet, it's most closely connected to some of the transportation demand management strategies that we might talk about, creating transportation choices, but also, again, maximizing the benefits of what you have. As simple, for instance, as bike lanes, if you build bike lanes and don't sweep them regularly, they don't get used because the automobiles tend to push all the debris into the bike lane. And then so you then spent millions of dollars on a facility that's not terribly usable by the desired user if you don't also maintain it. So I think the countywide policies recognize that was a challenge for a lot of agencies. And so it's an opportunity to create policy that says, you know, that's a valuable expenditure, is that maintenance is just as important, if not more important, than building the facility in the first place. And similarly with roadways, if you don't correct potholes as they come up, then your travel lanes aren't very effective. And if you don't regularly evaluate your traffic signals and change the timing or change the phasing, add turn arrows when they're needed, you don't get the most efficiency out of that system either.
What would you say about the surface? If the surface doesn't clean up well, like Northeast 20th, Southeast 20th, the bike lane there, it's green and collects glass. Same situation, you can't maintain it, so it's not really an effective bike lane.
Yeah, that's true. If it's true that you can't maintain it, there, you know, there's always that challenge. Is the easier it is to maintain, you then start losing some other things. A very smooth surface is not good for traction either. And actually, pavement markings can be a significant hazard to bicycles, especially the what we call the thermoplastic ones that become polished after vehicles drive over them, and even cars skid on them, let alone bicycles. So they're now, manufacturers are actually coming up with plastic pavement markings that have minerals all the way through them. So as they wear, they're still generating that rough surface. But it's a new technology, especially the colored materials that were used here. But that's the trade-off, is you get very good traction and actually better visibility with that third dimension to the texture, but it's a little harder to maintain. So mobility. So I wanted to kind of talk about the different modes a little more specifically, and kind of what we can do about them, what you can choose to do or recommend we do. And starting with walking trips, they're generally, I put less than a mile. Most transportation planners, for transit planning, it's even a quarter mile, which if you think about it, is not very far. That's 1,200 feet or so. It's not a tremendous walk. 1 mile gets to be some effort for most people. That takes some time. But even if we look at a 1 mile walking shed for various activities, it directs those improvements or needs in the city to different locations than we would typically see if we look at automobile planning. So we're really, those bike needs really radiate out from the arterials, because the buses are on the arterials, and in Sammamish the buses are primarily on 228th. And Sahali Way and 43rd, depending where you are, the name changes. But really thinking about how you get people and which people can reasonably get to those transit services within a mile. There's some design things that affect that in terms of cul-de-sacs or grid systems. You know, sometimes you could be a quarter mile from a transit stop, but it takes a mile and a half to walk there because the neighborhoods aren't connected either by streets or even non-motorized facilities. Again, from a transportation planning perspective, more than maybe recreational or some of the community health attributes, is we really want to look at how we connect walking trips to that next mode of regional transportation that supports growth. And so that's primarily a walk to transit, or a walk to work, or a walk to services. Those are the things we can influence the most. Typically, the problem with walking trips is the facility is usually not there. It's pretty rare that we have a sidewalk along a street that is so crowded with pedestrians on it that we need to widen the sidewalk, like we might need to widen a street. Might be a good problem to have someday. But in general, it's because the facility isn't there. But it also is a fairly easy thing for the city to address, because all of those sidewalk needs are in the city of Sammamish. They're on existing roadways or planned roadways, and it's a project the city can implement on its own. Looking at bicycle trips, they become a little longer. And that's a regional trend, that bicycle commuting has been gaining popularity, and the average length of bicycle trips is increasing. So not only are people riding to transit centers, but they're also riding all the way to work. I live on down on between the trail and the East Lake Sammamish Parkway, and there are two or three people I see every night. They get there after me. I'm still driving from Redmond, but I see folks that are actually commuting regularly, even on the gravel trail. When it's paved, it'll probably be better. But compared to the amount of people that use it for recreation, that commuting function is probably a little lower. Again, the opportunities are typically limited to a lack of facility, not an overcrowding of facilities. And again, most of the solutions, now that you have a regional trail, really the local solutions are available for the city to deal with.
You talked about using the gravel trail and paved trail down below for commuting. It's not your belief that the commuters will still stay above next to the roadway?
Some will, some won't. And actually, during commuting, I would say probably the AM commute, it's going to be fairly lightly traveled. There won't be a lot of recreational users. It's all about sort of competing for that space, and it depends how well it's improved when they pave it. If there's room for everybody, they will still stay down there. The parkway, you know, doesn't have a vertical separation between the vehicles and the shoulders, and that can cause some challenges if you don't have a more well-defined facility. But you'll see both. There'll be a mix. Burke Gilliman Trail is a good example. It's heavily used by both commuters and recreational bicyclists.
There's no real alternative, though, next to the Lake City Way for bicycles, though. There's no bike lane on Lake City Way.
Right. And I'm currently passed by a few bicycles every morning on East Lake Sammamish Parkway going northbound. For the last mile, they go faster than the cars.
More now than a year ago, right?
So getting to auto trips, again, these become much longer, but generally, you know, there aren't a lot of people that commute more than 50 miles. It's in the 20 to 30 mile range, and it's getting shorter as well. Occasionally, that trip is going to be to, again, to that next mode, you know, to a park and ride or a light rail station. But here it is the congestion on the existing facility that's typically the problem. It's not that there's not a road at all, that's pretty rare, but that the road is full. But also, particularly for Sammamish, the congestion is often caused by factors outside of our control, is the decisions that Redmond and the state make at East Lake Sammamish Parkway and Highway 202 really determine how much congestion you're going to have at the north end of East Lake Sammamish Parkway, and the decisions that Issaquah makes at Southeast 56th Street and the Pickering Place determine how much congestion you're going to have there, and the decisions made up at Issaquah Falls City Road and Issaquah Pine Lake Road, which may or may not be within your control, really have a big function in terms of congestion. The other one, however, is that we've been seeing is with the large schools and development on 228, that there is some localized congestion that occurs as well. Schools fairly short duration. They have a very sharp peak because everyone's arriving at once, typically. And that is something that potentially a travel demand management or system management plan of some kind could help address.
I think we're also seeing recently, at least along 228, is that congestion is a function of utility line work going on along 228 there. And I don't know how much of that is systemic and how much of that is acute things like tree trimming and stuff like that. But if that's something that's going to be occurring along 228th, along that stretch. However, in little segments along the way, that's going to continue to impact, and it has a fairly significant effect on commute times.
Yeah, they're doing a pretty major pole replacement project right now, so that's not something they do very often. That's every 10 or 20 years effort. But, you know, managing the impacts of maintenance and other utility work is even a regional issue. It becomes much more critical for, you know, bridges on highways. It starts having huge effects, but it has similar effects on local arterials when you don't have a lot of choice.
Victor, you're looking at this by miles. Can you tell me if you looked at it by time also? Would you say that the times are going up or the times are going down for the average commute?
The travel times are going up because speeds are going down. So
they're still traveling the same distance. It's just taking them longer.
Yeah. Some people are making choices. I mean, in the last year, I moved from a job that was 13 and a half miles from my house to one that was 7.5 miles from my house. So I'm saving some time, and I'm also saving the aggravation of I-405, which is worth it. And it's even if it takes me the same time, not having to get on 405 is good. But I do want to keep going so we can digest all this. Again, transit trips typically are replacing an automobile trip. In some cases, they replace a longer walk or bicycle trip. Here, the challenge becomes kind of two-phased. The service is provided by others. But you do have control about accessing that service in terms, as we talked about before, providing bicycle and pedestrian access so we maximize the number of people that can get to it is an important factor to consider in your policies. And then provision of additional service is possible. Metro has a community mobility program. I brought a copy of it somewhere. You can buy that service. I think the city is currently paying $56,000 a year for the service that exists, which is about 10%. So give you a ballpark of how much transit service costs. And you can also purchase shuttle service, which might be another thing to consider as we're looking at reducing demand internally, is what would a shuttle circulating within the city, connecting schools and services and parks and recreation, what would that do? And also the park and ride, so you could maybe avoid taking your car to the park and ride that's probably full.
Question on that one. So how many cities in our area, peer cities, besides Seattle, supplement
I think there are, three or four other cities that are participating with you on your route?
Yes, the Route 269 partnership is the City of Issaquah, City of Redmond, City of Sammamish, and Microsoft Corporation are all partnering to provide extra trips on the Route 269. And then Seattle, this is with the Transit Now partnership program that came out several years ago. So that group I just mentioned, City of Seattle also has some partnership routes. I'm not aware if there's other agencies that are still successfully doing that. There were several that applied, and either through a lack of success on the routes or a lack of funding, those have kind of fallen by the wayside.
Yeah, Issaquah used to fund a local shuttle, and then Metro took it over, and then I'm not sure of the status of it now. It might even be gone.
Yeah, the Route 200 was funded by Issaquah, and it's basically Metro is waiting to pull the plug. Issaquah is not committed to funding it anymore, so it'll probably disappear pretty soon.
And do we have data on the Microsoft shuttles also? I know I see several of them going back and forth during the day, and I don't know how full they are and if they're being fully utilized, or do we know?
We coordinate with those folks, and they are fairly well utilized. But that being said, it's pretty expensive route because of the higher class of buses and just that it's a dedicated route. Microsoft is more interested in partnering with the city to fund more routes on public transit than doing those other shuttle services. And part of the reason the shuttle service is just to be competitive with other peer employers as well.
Yeah, the cooperation with the other agencies is there's value there because of the avoided automobile trip at this end of the route means less parking and less congestion at the other end of the route as well. So being able to understand those connections and having both cities benefit then means you can share the cost of that service more effectively.
Yeah. It also reduces the traffic jam trying to get off at 41st or 51st.
Right.
Over there in Redmond.
Yeah, if you can fill a bus with 45 people, that's 45 cars. You notice that at a traffic signal.
So one of the reasons I kind of wanted to pause there and just ask these questions is because I do get a sense a lot of times when people talk about transit solutions, and we over and over again we hear about people want mobility, they want more transit, and then there's often a shrug, when you get to implementation or to really talking about it, everyone shrugs and says, oh, well, we don't control Metro. So now may not be the time, but I'm hoping that as a commission, we can talk a little bit about exploring that and whether there's investment, and it's not cheap, but whether that's something that the city should be considering to meet all these objectives we keep circling around.
It's certainly possible. I mean, I just pulled this out. It's the program is the Community Mobility Contracts Program. So you can essentially contract with Metro for whatever you want to pay for. So it's not that you can't get it, but it's the challenge is how are you going to pay for it? Is it a $60 per car license fee like Seattle adopted? Is it something else? But there will be a price tag with it. So don't think about it as you can't. There's the barriers gone with this mobility contract, but it's how would you find the revenue for it?
We're not a taxing authority for license plates, though, are we? The city of Sammamish?
Yes, you can do a transportation benefit district.
Yeah, I think TBD, transportation benefit district, so any local agency can and the rates have changed. I believe they're up to, I think it's $40 now. Maybe it's more after update, but yes, the local agencies have that provision to do that.
Huh. Didn't know.
But I guess maybe the point being that we may not know what the how is, but I know for sure that if we don't talk about even the desire to do so, we're going to go through another comprehensive planning cycle where we don't really seriously. I just want to have a serious conversation about whether it's a good idea, and then we can have the question, have the conversation about whether and how much it should be funded. But I hate it. It seems like this concept gets greeted with a shrug and, oh, well, we don't control that, and the conversation ends. And so,
yeah, and a policy, you know, is most typically a should statement. The city should consider. You fill in the blank, and so you don't have to know how to do it.
Yeah, it may not be sufficient to say that we want to do it, but it sure is necessary as a first step, is how I'm viewing it.
Yeah.
So
yeah, there could be a lot of resistance if there's not a policy supporting that endeavor. Then someone say, well, your plan doesn't say anything about supporting
that's
or
my
buying
point.
Transit.
Yeah,
systems.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I think too that speaking about the Microsoft shuttles, again, those are Microsoft shuttles. And Microsoft is, while a considerably large employer with probably a percentage of the trips, there are also other large employers in that corridor that could be serviced by a, let's call it a tech employees shuttle of some sort, you know, something that encompassed more than just Microsoft employees that took them to that area. I think, and I don't know if as a, let's say if I was a Nintendo employee right across the street from Microsoft, can I take the Microsoft bus or do I need to show my badge?
Yeah, and there, I think there are some governance issues because Microsoft can't compete with Metro. So if they begin to involve other
like
agencies, then there's, they can, but they aren't allowed to. So that is a governance problem in terms of how that would happen. So I think we covered this one. Another issue is moving people with special needs. There's what's called the ADA Transition Plan, Americans with Disabilities Act. And there was it originally started relative to buildings. It's now moving forward into what we call the public right-of-way, but those guidelines are not adopted. There's a proposed rule, the federal government's calling it, in terms of how to handle accessibility for roadways and sidewalks. And so that's something you might want to consider in terms of how that priority of doing that. There's a lot of retrofitting. The new standards are very different than the old standards. So virtually any curb ramp at an intersection that was constructed 5 or 7 years ago doesn't meet the current standard anymore. It's a very rigid standard now. So some cities are spending as much on curb ramp replacements as they are on their pavement overlay program. If they're doing $1 million of overlay, that almost costs that much to get back up to ADA standards. So it's a very expensive
endeavor. Will that continue?
Huh?
Will the changes continue on that code?
I think the intent. Well, this is implementation of that proposed rule. So right now, it's kind of being treated as best available science. I don't know that it would change more, but it has evolved almost steadily every 10 years. The standard for curb ramps and things get a little different.
It's not necessarily that the standards have changed, just they've not been built correctly.
Oh, the old ones.
So the standards, you go back 10 years and the standards, the ramps were not being built correctly, partly because the designs weren't clear enough and partly because there wasn't a lack of attention or awareness of the need to comply.
So the standard's not quite there yet, but it's coming. So, and then again, the other one, moving people, it was on a kind of a regional policy and on the tracking sheet as well, is there are those who either can't drive or don't want to drive, and what kind of, so ADA kind of covers maybe some of the people that can't, and then the non-motorized and transit options are for those who choose not to, that they want an option. Part of the regional strategy is also moving goods. So primarily in Sammamish, that's accommodating trucks safely. We don't have a lot of trucks, but when they do need to be able to access the commercial centers, trucks haven't been getting smaller the way vehicles and cars typically have. They seem to be getting bigger because one big truck is cheaper to run than three small trucks. So you'll see even a small McDonald's has a 67-foot truck delivering hamburger buns to it. So it's more a design policy in terms of making sure that those trucks, when they're going to primarily commercial areas, aren't creating pedestrian and bicycle hazards because they take up a lot more roadway. So you have to consider those. And then supporting growth, both locally and regionally. So really the way Sammamish can support regional growth is connecting primarily the housing we have here with the employment that is available in the region. But also doing that efficiently, and that requires primarily coordinating with transit if we want to give people a choice other than a car. And then connecting Sammamish housing with employment internally, the town center will be able to generate a significant amount of employment there. And so how can we facilitate that? That starts becoming some of those shorter trips. Hopefully there'll be some live-work type units there that have no trip, maybe just downstairs to where your job. But again, those are really the two ways that you're supporting growth, is connecting the jobs externally and then internally. And then the system operations, which we might want to even just call, kind of think about more as sustainability, is really getting the most out of the infrastructure you have. So, you know, some agencies are looking at policies where, you do all the sort of technical soft things you can do before you add a lane. So you look at things like, I think the city of Seattle, actually one council member just proposed implementing adaptive signal control in the Mercer corridor to help it work a little better. And the city's also looking at something similar. So what are techniques that get more value out of the system you have rather than just building more? And especially here where, again, the bottlenecks are at either end, how can, you know, you have limited control over those improvements.
Is it possible that it'll work on Mercer?
It's demonstrated to be a little better. It's seldom, you know, it's not going to be a day and night where you turn on adaptive signal control and everything's fine, because if you make it a little better, then cars will just come. I mean, traffic pretty much increases to the point of level service E or F, and then people choose another route. So tolling's typically much more effective, because as important as we think congestion is, as soon as someone asks you to pay $2 to save 15 minutes, it's not worth it anymore. And that's fascinating to me in terms of how effective tolling can be versus just letting something get bad. People tolerate it much more. And if you say, well, for $2, would the congestion be gone? Nope, I'll stick here.
So, do we have the infrastructure for doing any of that adaptive signaling across 228, or is that also a capital cost for new hardware, sensors, blah, blah, blah?
We've actually got a project that we're in design right now that's going to implement adaptive signal control on 228th, the whole corridor of 228th from Northeast 12th all the way down to Issaquah Pine Lake Road. So that should be installed next summer.
Awesome. Thanks.
Will it be able to accommodate any traffic circles that we may wish to have in the future?
Well, it's just for signals. So if you take the signal out, so it only operates the signals.
But I assume it's sequencing them.
They're all talking to each other. So
if you change the system to a traffic circle, the system will adapt to it.
Correct.
It won't become obsolete.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay. So again, some design things that help us get kind of more efficiency out of it, and some things just, you know, having driven around here for the last 30 years. You know, the illumination systems in the city, you know, typically when a roadway is built, you also get a new illumination system, which makes those non-motorized facilities feel a lot safer. So again, people choose to use non-motorized facilities both when they're there and when they feel safe. There's kind of a security aspect. When you're in the cocoon of your car, you're not as worried about the condition of the road or whether there's street lights outside. You're locked in this big steel thing. But if you're walking or riding a bicycle, you're a little more concerned about, can I see in the bushes next to me? Can I see ahead of me? Can I see cars that might be approaching? So there's an element of design that is more human for non-motorized facilities, as you'd expect. And then you mentioned before materials for the roadway, for sidewalks. I think there was a comment about scoring and joints in concrete sidewalks and what they do to various users. They provide a very important function, so it's extremely difficult to take them out. You actually have to use something other than concrete. Concrete expands and contracts a lot. It's surprising how much concrete moves. It's why bridges have the big joints at either end of a large bridge structure. They move 5 or 6 inches as they get hot and cold. And sidewalks need those joints every 5 to 10 feet because they expand and contract quite a bit. And I actually did a sidewalk project in Mount Vernon where the contractor failed to put those joints in, kind of put quarter joints in that were only an inch deep, and also built the sidewalk in the winter when it was really cold, and the next summer it expanded so much that at every driveway the sidewalk popped up and went over the thicker driveway section by about an inch. So while they have the detriment of being a little bump in the road, they keep the bigger bumps from happening. So.
Yeah, but it keeps bikers off the sidewalks where it might be appropriate to have them on the sidewalk.
Bicycles on sidewalks is not a safe solution. You're much more likely to get in an accident if you ride your bike on a sidewalk.
We're mixing bikes and pedestrians everywhere.
If you're going fast enough that a sidewalk joint on a bicycle is a problematic, then you probably don't want to mix them at that speed differential. If someone's going slow enough to be mixed with pedestrians, then I don't think the joints would cause a problem. I think something else to think about is, or kind of a personal, another little personal thought is, we design bicycles for velodromes in the United States. You know, they have tires this big, and you have to have a perfect surface for the bicycle, where if you look at a European bicycle, it's a little more like an off-road bike. It can handle cobblestones and things, and I think that's something that's going to have to evolve is really commuter bicycles should not look the same as a racing bicycle. They should be a little sturdier. They should be able to expect some debris in the road or cracks and things, just like our cars aren't designed like race cars, but our bicycles are the equivalent of taking a NASCAR car on a roadway, which doesn't work at all. So that's a little divergence.
Do you have a preferred material for sidewalks?
Huh?
Do you have a preferred material that might be different than concrete for sidewalks?
Not really. It's about the most durable one, because the flexible ones like asphalt get deformed very easily, and you replace the rigid joint with rolling, and they just deteriorate a little lot faster. So I'm sure we can look at some, there are some variables in joint design that could be looked at if that's a concern. On the maintenance side, we talked a little bit about sweeping pothole repair. You might want policies that encourage that, so that when the city is looking at budget shortfalls, potentially there's some policy that says, you cut maintenance before new construction, keep maintaining what you have, or build the new thing and eliminate congestion.
Is there a formula for that, like what you consider for, I say, a mile of mixed use sidewalk street, for what you would want a percentage of that to be for maintenance over time?
Not that I'm aware of. There probably is one. There are pavement management systems. We've done a lot with roads, so there are very sophisticated systems about how much you should invest in keeping the roadway pavement. But again, the non-motorized facilities tend to, the weights, people walking on concrete, it doesn't get worn out by the people walking on it. It gets damaged by roots. It gets damaged by trucks that drive over it. But it's not the user that's wearing out a bike lane or a sidewalk, so there's not as much information available. So it's a relatively minor cost. It primarily is correcting damage and sweeping more than it is, keeping it from wearing out.
Emily, is there anything on the parking lot under illumination as far as night sky pollution, light pollution? Okay, thank you. Does it need to be in transportation for this illumination or not?
Actually, our standards already call for, the current standards are dark sky friendly lighting.
And then on the operation side, again, looking at sort of sustainable options that make the most out of what you have. We talked about smart signals. You mentioned also roundabouts. They're kind of smart by design. but also variable message signing that could be used to say more than, you know, I observe the one on East Lake Sammamish Parkway. It typically just talks about road closures, but there could be a lot more information. The sign could say, if you'd left half an hour ago, your trip would have taken 15 minutes less or 20 minutes less, or, you know, and DOT is doing that on I-405 now. At the, when you're north of I-405, there's a sign on I-5 that says, if you want to go to, you know, Federal Way via I-5, it's this many minutes, and if you want to go via 405, it's more or less. And
do the signs themselves create congestion or not?
I wouldn't say they offer choices. So especially when they give you the travel time difference between the tolled route and the untolled route, you can then make that economic choice. Am I going to pay $3 to save?
But does the average person slow down to read that sign? No. Or does it? Okay.
No, the average person ignores most 80% of the signs on a highway, actually. So they seldom slow people down. The big flashing ones, you know, during an event will slow people down. And DOT's learning. They don't warn you as soon about a incident or accident ahead. They used to give you like 20 miles warning. There's an accident 20 miles up, and that did have some pretty negative effects. So now they're keeping that warning a little closer to the incident so that people aren't jockeying for position too early. So
I think the
systems are so new, we're really learning how to use them.
I think also it has to offer realistic choices. I know there's one coming south that offers you getting to Bellevue by going through downtown Seattle over the 520 versus the 405. And I've never done that, even when it said it was more time, because I just don't believe them. You know, it's like there's no way going through downtown. Yeah. And I just wonder if we've identified optional routes that we would say this versus that. I mean, really, we only have 228th, right? I mean, right. Well, you can either drive on 228th or you can, I don't know, stay home. Yeah. You know, I'd like to give people some options.
Yeah. And often the choice is, you know, hey, if you wait 20 minutes, you know, it's going to take you 3 minutes less to drive home or 10 minutes less to drive home. There's that, you know, a lot of our problems are fairly short duration. It might even be an hour that's bad. So could you rearrange your life so that your commute time missed that worst part of the hour? And typically there's a 15-minute window in that hour that's really bad. And if you can miss that, you're in pretty good shape.
Like, for instance, the city does have a couple of traffic cameras out there, and I used to look at those occasionally, but now I've noticed that, like, the WashDOT app has a lot of our major arterial surface streets, and it's actually quite accurate. Mm-hmm. Displayed in an accident that slowed my wife down that made me think I was going to bring my kids here tonight, torture them for 5 minutes, but I didn't have to. She got through.
Yeah, and actually the private sector, you know, has found a lot of value in that information, so there are a lot of private businesses that sell that information. There's INRIX where you can get that information. It'll give you multiple travel time. It'll say, you can tell, I want the least travel time. I don't care where you send me, just what's the shortest path in time. So those are services, you know, and AM radio stations have been doing it since there was an AM radio station in a car, is they fly around and watch things, and that's some
information. Now they do it every 10 minutes, 24/7.
That's right. And if you switch stations, you can get it every 5 minutes. So those are some things, again, operational things that you can talk about. Safety, we talked a little bit about. And so just again, as we think of goals and policies, remember that for the non-motorized, there is this sort of personal security aspect of it, that, you know, a bike lane by itself without probably improvements in illumination and other things won't be nearly as effective as one that's really human-friendly. And then all these other efficiency, primarily, again, trying to avoid widening, getting the most out of what you have. On the sustainability side, a lot of new information on construction methods and materials. You actually score better on grants now if you show that you're reusing, recycling, and reducing waste on a construction project. Maintenance methods, I'm sure the city's already has in place. And then green infrastructure that I wouldn't specify a certain type. I would just, you know, recommend that you think about policies that encourage looking at innovations, because a lot of times public agencies, you know, want to see it work for 15 years before they try it. So there's a risk in looking at innovations, but there's also often benefits and rewards from that.
How do you rate your surfaces for green? What's impervious concrete and impervious asphalt rating out for you? Is it a good alternative?
Everything's context sensitive. You know, impervious pavements, especially the city of Sammamish, is built on a lot of glacial till. So 6 inches under that impervious, or that pervious pavement is an impervious soil, so it has limited benefit. It's kind of tough to do those types of things. So often for like asphalt, it's recycled asphalt, and even concrete, it's recycled concrete. Is when someone tears a building down, let's use that as the aggregate for the new sidewalk we build. Or if we're going to repave an asphalt roadway, you grind the asphalt up, mix it with new oil, and put it back down. There's actually even some machines now that do the whole thing at once, that eat up the old road and a new road comes out the back. It's about a 300-foot machine, but it's possible to do. So it's really, often it doesn't have to be super sophisticated. It's just trying not to waste things, trying to use recycled or use some other person's waste to make something new.
And are those technologies that are reasonable within a city context, or are they more effective in a more regional context, like reuse of concrete and stuff like that? Is that something that happens at a city level, or is that more coordinated at a larger level?
Yeah, because as almost all the cities are requiring it, and so the contractors, they're, you know, batching plants and facilities that accept concrete waste from every city, and then they crush it, process it, and it goes back out to all the cities. So you don't have to do the whole process internally, regionally. It's already available.
So you could just say, I'm using contractor X, and contractor X uses recycled materials from all over, therefore I'm compliant with a more sustainable policy. Yeah.
Or really, you just specify in your construction documents, the contractor will, and then the contractors that can will bid on your project, the contractors that can't won't. You just make it a condition of your contract. So that was that. We not get this?
I don't know what happened.
Yeah, we had some issues with the last slides, so I'll just look at that one. So again, we'll go here. So based on the feedback we get tonight, we'll be working on some draft policies for your review next meeting in December. And then also, there are several required technical sessions that really come out of the policies you establish, and some really almost have nothing to do with policy. But under GMA, we're required to do a system inventory, essentially typically a map and a spreadsheet of what the city has in terms of roadways, transit systems, airports, and marine terminals that we don't have. Documenting the city's level of service standard, actions to address current LOS deficiencies, which are pretty much already captured. You don't have current deficiencies in terms of things that wouldn't be eligible for impact fees on the arterial system. And then a 10-year minimum forecast is a requirement. We do a 20-year forecast, and right now that's already, the 20-year forecast for the new land use, the PSRC allocation of, oh, it was after that. Okay, I was doing things too fast probably. So, yeah, so we've run the model. Basically, the town center plan has the employment and residential capacity to meet the current PSRC growth allocations for Sammamish. So we didn't have to do any additional forecasting to determine if the transportation system was adequate. So the current 20-year capital list that's in the impact fee program is an adequate project list to meet those needs. And then taking the policies on pedestrian and bicycle components is establishing some enhanced information at this time, but also there's an issue about incorporating the transportation, the trails, pathways, and bikes plan. I always get them in the wrong order. So that plan was older. It didn't have concrete recommendations for projects nor funding in it. So the policies that you establish about non-motorized facilities will help future efforts into getting that finalized. And then a transportation demand management component, again, on the policy level, that's something you'll be working on so that we meet that criteria for GMA. The funding and financial strategy are really updates to what the city's currently doing in terms of funding the transportation plans. However, you know, we might have to add sections if we want to begin to look at supplementing transit service. So that would be a cost and a revenue that is not currently in the city's financial strategy for transportation. And then the contingency is, what do you do policy-wise? You're encouraged to come up with a a policy that says the, you know, do you adjust your level of service first? So again, if you're short the money to build out the transportation system, do you tolerate more congestion? Do you tolerate more vehicle congestion but keep spending on non-motorized access to transit or keep funding transit service? Or do you change your land use plan and say, well, we simply can't build enough infrastructure to accommodate the land use we want, so we're going to essentially not meet the regional strategy of supporting growth and say we can't. So they said there's a suggestion that you have that hierarchy of what do you do first, and the suggestion is not supporting growth is the last alternative, is that you would look at some other adjustments to your plan before that would happen. And then an intergovernmental coordination strategy, because as we talked about, several things require either coordination with Metro, coordination with Sound Transit, potentially coordination with Redmond and Issaquah for jointly dealing with congestion at the edges of the city, although they're, again, those facilities are so big now that there's limited opportunities to make them any better. So it's really thinking about how you deal with constraints both to the north and south, and where you want to invest and what benefits you want to get.
You know, Victor, on that intergovernmental coordination strategy, I wonder if there's something we should be considering related to the Duthie Hill Notch. I know, at least in the land use element, we've had a little bit of discussion about, you know, what can we do in working with the county, maybe to annex the area, which would give us control over the roadway. And I know that's got its own issues. Put that over here. But I wonder if there's some other way that we can work with King County, at least on the road infrastructure piece, to help alleviate that bottleneck. I mean, because that's really what it is.
I will interject here. I would think it's more of a city leadership policy in terms of, I'm pretty confident if you went to King County and asked if we could improve their road, they would say, have at it.
Sure.
It's just a matter of perception of spending money outside the city limits.
Right.
I think that's what it boils down to.
Yeah. And there are, you know, regional pools of funding for projects like that, where there's, you know, Puget Sound Regional Council has a competitive program for the region. So if you can demonstrate that this is a regional project that's in King County but benefits and is affected by Sammamish and Issaquah and others, then if all those participating agencies agree, because Issaquah is sending trips out on Issaquah Falls City Road, hence the name. Falls City doesn't have any potential revenue to contribute, but a joint application, for instance, with Sammamish and Issaquah and King County all together, with each of them participating maybe 5% of that project cost, all of a sudden that starts boiling up to a fundable project on a regional scale.
And just to add to that, there's also, of course, there's the morning commute, but there's also the recreation. And I know at least one of my fellow commissioners might agree that there's a fantastic regional asset there at Duthie Hill Bike Park. And getting across that is terrifying. And I ride bikes a lot, and it's a big deal. So there could be lots of ways to roll that into. If that's something we're talking about looking at that, we want to incorporate the recreational aspect, because that's a prime asset.
It might be interesting in terms of intergovernmental coordination to actually not just make it a wish, but actually start to outline what we would consider a plan for that. You know, so if there's, what is the mechanism, for example, by which we would talk to Sammamish about co-located transportation corridors that need coordination? I don't know that there is. I mean, it's one thing to say there's intergovernmental coordination strategy, but is there somebody that does that? Is there some more concrete way that we address those intergovernmental issues other than wishing we could do them?
Yeah, and again, that really is for regional transportation. It is the Puget Sound Regional Council. That is their job, is to look for those projects that connect different pieces of the region. So there is a mechanism in place for that. And the other part of it is just, again, a policy to help establish, you know, we could work on something that talked about participating in facilities outside the city limits that benefit or affect city residents. And that way you're not actually tying it to one specific project. And it means that if you in the future chose to build a full interchange, help Redmond do a full interchange at 202 and East Lake Sammamish Parkway to help with that, it would put those types of things on the table. So a policy essentially saying the city should consider spending money outside the city limits if it provides benefits to transportation and mobility within the city.
And enumerating some possible opportunities for that, like Puget Sound Regional Council, whatever that was, you acronym me throughout there.
Yeah, you got it.
Okay.
I got three. By the way, I think you did a fantastic job, and I really like the tracking sheet. It was very good to go over everything. I really think you captured a lot. I have three items I'd like to see on the parking lot. One is on a 30,000-foot level. We haven't discussed how are we going to handle capacity regressions. Okay, so let's say we do things that we think are going to work but do not, and actually decrease the capacity for our infrastructure. What's our typical way of handling that? I haven't seen it mentioned at all, and I do foresee some regressions in the next 10 years. The next one is, we talked a little bit about density change by transportation feature. I'm big time into that, and what is the policy? How is it going to progress over time? If we do get a transportation center in one part of the city, should we automatically look at our code as far as density so that we can optimize the use of that center? My opinion, yes. And then the last one is, when we talk about reviewing and improving current infrastructure, we don't really get into the internet thing. And I think there should be even pressure from the transportation segment of this to upgrade the internet to at least 1 gigabyte. The people that can work at home don't drive cars. I mean, it's really important if we're going to offer a technology corridor to give them something to work with where they don't have to drive a car. Thank you.
I also have one point back on from your first slide. You mentioned climate change, and I'm curious where you're baselining that and what your projections for impact on transportation, does it belong there? I would say yes, opinion. But I'm curious what you, where you see that impacting, and if you see it impacting, what kind of baselines are you using for that? And the 2035 is a long time in climate change, so.
Right, and really, really basing it more on adopted policy by the state. Is there is a policy that says agencies should be making efforts to reduce essentially travel demand, vehicle miles of travel per capita. There's a statewide reduction goal. And so that does play into that kind of smart grid and really shortening trips or swapping modes, getting people out of the car into another mode. So it's really not about trying to measure greenhouse gas emissions in Sammamish, but it's about measuring, or at least understanding, is that trend being accomplished? Because I'm not aware of an agency yet that's actually measuring whether they're reducing vehicle miles of travel per person on an annual basis yet. But so the intent is to very, again, kind of combine it with transportation demand management, that if you're getting people to switch modes, you are reducing vehicle miles of travel. Which is the biggest bang for your buck. Changing from a gas-powered car to an electric car helps a little bit, but avoiding the trip altogether helps quite a bit, because then you get into discussions, well, what was the climate change implication of building the electric car versus it's still better to take the bus. So we try to avoid, you know, you can spend more measuring it than you do promoting a lot of things that could help reduce it qualitatively, if not quantitatively. So it's really an effort to be consistent with that statewide policy that we should be looking at ways to reduce travel demand and vehicle miles of travel.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from the commission at this point?
Nice job.
Yeah, thank you, Victor. Mm-hmm. And Jeff.
I'm getting a word. There's some mention earlier about a desire for some goals to express the city, you know, have a goal that would support providing transit service, either just as a standalone goal, or perhaps I might offer, consider augmented transit service whenever you're considering a capital improvement to expand capacity, that maybe that's part of the decision tree as well. Evaluate providing additional transit service versus spending the money to put more asphalt down. And I just wanted to ask if there's a unanimous opinion on that, or a majority.
No, I think it's worth pursuing. we don't have it as a policy, then it makes it difficult to go down that road or not go down that road.
So to speak.
Thank you.
Victor, if I can make a comment, I may have read it very quickly, but I have not seen much discussion about transit-oriented development. Is this not something feasible in semi-urban area like ours, or that's totally dedicated toward Bellevue, Redmond, Seattle?
We didn't talk about it. It's been implemented. I think the most applicable to Sammamish would be one that's under construction in Kirkland. It's actually right on the border of Kirkland and Bellevue at 108th on the north side of 520. And it was essentially the redevelopment of a at-grade park and ride into a structured park and ride with some housing and a little bit of main floor retail commercial. So mixed use added on, so fairly small scale. So that's something potentially could happen at one of your commercial nodes or at town center. And I don't think your current, at least geographically, it could be possible. So you almost have it. I mean, town center has everything, but the park and ride part of it. And if we can get the same number or more people to access the transit without the park and ride, because a park and ride lot by itself actually generates traffic quite a bit right there. So you build a 500 car parking garage, that's the equivalent of 500 employees or 500 homes in one driveway. So the better type of transit oriented development is what you did for town center, which is put a lot of residential units within a very reasonable walking distance of the routes you already have, because you don't have a lot of transfers that are taking place where you would need north south buses meeting east west buses at a common area where you could also shop. That's not the kind of transit-oriented development I would see here. So I think it's really maximizing the routing you have on 228th, maximizing what happens at the park and ride. You know, something around there would be helpful.
And to put that in a slightly different context, I kind of think of transit-oriented developments as more of a land use issue. Sammamish isn't quite to the point where we're needing to build garages to house people that want to take buses, I think you're right about the town center acting like a transit oriented development, just mm-hmm. not on top of a parking garage. But it's something I think we should definitely think about and look at for our land use element.
And we do have minimally that concept, at least with regards to the Microsoft buses. They're sort of a park and ride type situation, although I imagine they're contracting that space. I don't know, but whether that could be either expanded to other locations or something like that. I don't know. Those are the mini park and rides, I guess I would call them, you know.
I think what I was getting at has to do with chicken or egg question. If you don't have density, then you don't have transit. And, you need to support, in order to support transit, you need to have density. And if we don't build density, then there's no point of bringing the transit. So I'm just wondering, how do we create that sweet spot within the small town center and along 228 that we have?
Yeah, and there is a relationship between the type of transit and the density. Right. The density you need to support light rail is very different than the density you need to support regional bus service. So actually you could overdevelop and overwhelm regional bus service if you weren't careful. So the density numbers, 80 units per acre that someone might be throwing out next to a light rail station is not what you would want to try to do here, because that would be a train of buses as long as 228th to try to get the service to make that density work. So there's a balance where we have to recognize we are primarily single family with some multifamily nodes. And so again, it's that's managing the system. What's a reasonable frequency of bus service, and then we could look at what a reasonable density along that corridor is. And I think you might have that density if you could get that half mile or 1 mile walk very comfortable from all the residential. If you think of 228th as sort of your transit oriented development, since that's where the buses are from one end to the other, and then look out half a mile or a mile, you probably have the density there if we could make that walk or bike ride to the bus pleasant.
Is storage for bikes a large component of that thought or not? Are you putting the bike on the bus, or are you doing storage for the bike at the pickup point?
There are both. There are some, you know, some park and rides typically have storage for bikes. Some of the buses, most of them have storage for bikes on the front. So, you know, if 5% of the people are using bikes, there's room for two or three bikes on the bus out of the 40 people that are on the bus. So, and I think that's something Metro could adjust to. I'm sure they could potentially make more room. But with bike sharing that's beginning to occur in Seattle, there's less reason to take your bike with you. You might be able to borrow a bike when you get to Seattle now. So things continually change, but I think that's a good point, is to, again, make that multimodal trip and that transfer from one mode to the other as easy as possible. So you would have to either provide the bike lockers or make it possible for the bike to go with you. You get one of those folding ones that gets as small as a briefcase.
In 15 years of bike bus commuting, I've only had one time when the bike rack was full, and I was on the waiting list for like 3 years, and I think they forgot my thing to get a locker at the Highlands Park and Ride. It just never went anywhere, so it was much easier to just throw it on the bus. And in 15 years, I've had one time when the bus was already full with three bikes.
Yeah, so again, it's like I said, with the non-motorized, it's usually the stuff is either there or not. It's very rarely overcrowded.
Right.
So if we first step for the next 10 years is just have it available, then we'll fill it up.
Okay. So we do have a public comment period for transportation. If anybody has any comments they'd like to provide to the commission on the presentation that Victor got, the discussion we had tonight, now's your opportunity up at our podium. Up to 7 minutes. If you do want to provide us comments, please give us your name. Yeah, I knew you were. Name and address. Is there anybody else? Just Manuel. Come on up, man. Welcome back.
A great presentation. Can you read the goals that we've been putting? So all I have to say is mostly a few items here. I'll probably start in a different order. I'll take we don't necessarily need to think about transfer-oriented development as nodes. Thinking in Vancouver, BC, transfer-oriented development basically originates density and affordable housing and providing housing opportunities to all the households. data and technology, some private startups or entrepreneurs developing private bus service, which is express bus service. Potentially a good market for that. So, and at some point, they're going to come to our city, knocking the door, asking for permission to our. That's the reason why Microsoft Connector actually uses price and not doesn't. So those are things to actually weigh in terms of leaving the door open for cities. That's about what I have. The only I would finish saying that the literature and the research around land use, transit service, and developing transit options, typically all they know 4Ds and some 5Ds and 6Ds. But they're basically density, providing density, providing design, good urban design. Networks, possibilities of connection. And there's diversity, which is the macro. Walking distance or bike distance to transit. Things are very important to consider in our stress. Or stress them. One last thing.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manuel.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that he said, I'd like to comment on. I'm all for allowing private uses for bus stops. If you can put that on the parking lot, I'd love to see what staff has to say about it.
Is there something preventing that now?
That's what he said.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Stop. It's unused capacity. How much is unused capacity worth? Pretty much zero.
Yeah. They have to stop it somewhere other than a metro stop.
I'd like to thank Manuel for helping me so I don't have to stutter on as many of the D's chat about this evening. I'd like to recap a comment a couple weeks ago about the town center because it folds back into a transportation. The question or comment was that we are suggesting in the southeast quadrant docket that is on the council's agenda that has been expanded for the whole of the town center. We're suggesting that the 2,000 residential unit cap be changed to the equivalent PMP, transportation of car trips. And in the current, and this handout today is some evidence in support of that, but I'll go over in just a sec. But the current has 100 single family homes, and it has 1,900 multi-family homes, average 0.7 p.m. peak trips, where the average house is one per day. Well, if the town center ends up to be only either cottage homes or two-story townhomes, then that's absolutely correct. But if the town center those car trip generations are half. They average about 0.35. If there's senior housing in the town center, they average about 0.2 or 0.25. We're suggesting that if the PM peak trip becomes the cap in the town center, and that if you allow 20% senior housing, 40% mixed-use housing, and keep 40% in one- and two-story housing, that will allow 3,800 units across the town center and not change car trips. Now, when you look at when the town center got, you know, adopted in 2006 and 2007, that was a whole lot of years ago. Actually got adopted in 2008. That started in 2006 and 2007. If you take a look at the facts behind what really makes mixed-use work, which is RTC vision for some of the town center, 8 to 9 units per acre average is not enough. It does need to be higher. So it's a way to achieve the town center vision and not increase the traffic. Now, besides that, in some research that's been completed by a Seattle firm, I've heard of these folks, Bear and Peters. They are traffic engineers. They studied 260 mixed-use projects in suburban settings across the entire U.S., and they found something fairly extraordinary with a 97% certainty rate. They have found that mixed-use environments in suburban settings reduce car trips by 35% over and above the ITE manual. So presently, our town center has a 7.7 trip count for all multifamily. We're suggesting that get changed to the actual trip count for the actual building code, and over and above that, consider this. Because if the commercial trips in the town center and the residential trips, if this holds true, there could be a significant change in figuring out what the correct scale in residential and commercial use is to enable our vision achieve the goals of smaller housing, economic needs, demographic needs of citizens for many years to come. And so again, I stutter on the D, so I'm not going to read all these, but Manuel is right. They found 8 D's that all matter, and interestingly enough, each one mattered, and they had a synergy. They worked together. So just because we don't have transit, that is only one of the 8 major factors. These things on their own support much less car trips within the town center. So it's a very interesting read, and it's very new, cutting edge information, just put out in roughly 2013. So our goal isn't to change the character of Sammamish, it's to achieve the vision in the town center plan, and we don't feel that 2,000 homes over 2,000 acres for the next 20 years can achieve the C vision of mixed use and many of the things that have been talked about in the last year. That's the presentation.
Thank you, Paul. Any other public comment this evening on transportation? Okay, seeing none, I'll close public comment on transportation. Jeff, Victor, anything else?
believe that's what we had for you tonight. Thank you. We're going to be at the next December 4th meeting, and we'll review the parking lot items and then come back with drafting some policies and goals and that are and use the tracking sheet for our guidance.
Great. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. So it's 7:50. I imagine we've probably got at least an hour left. How about we take a 5-minute break and then reconvene at 7:55. All right, sorry about that. We went a little over on our break. We're gonna get started back up. It's just about 8 o'clock. And we are going to start with tree retention. And I believe, Jeff, you're gonna kick us off on this?
Good evening, Planning Commission.
It's really loud.
It's very loud.
Got it?
You got it?
Okay, we'll try that again. Okay. Good evening, Jeff Thomas with Community Development. I'd like to, before I get started with tonight's presentation, introduce the gentleman sitting to my left is Mike Sugg, and he is a management intern that's working with us currently here at City Hall. He started with us in August, and he primarily works for the city manager's office, but they've been kind enough to loan him out to help us out with some research along the way, specifically in regards to tree retention policies, code provisions, and the such. So I've asked Mike to join us here tonight, and he's actually going to help me out a little later here in the presentation with a few of the slides. So with that, I'll get started and dive right in. This evening's presentation, we'd like to cover five primary objectives. First, we're going to have a discussion about the emergency ordinance that that council adopted on October 14th, essentially taking our our tree retention provisions and adopting an interim emergency ordinance with tree retention provisions. We're going to do a quick review of City Council compiled direction from a couple of different work sessions they've had for tree retention regulations. We'll do a quick review of the draft, a sampling of the draft tree retention policies that are part of your 2015 comp plan update. We'll share some information with you related to what exactly the Tree City USA program is, as well as what a ISA certified arborist is. And then lastly, we'll wrap it up with a quick look at the schedule for the rest of the calendar year and talk about where we'll be able to have some more discussion related to tree retention. Okay, summary of the regulations. So what we have in code currently, we have three different areas of the code related to tree retention. 21A15 specifically addresses tree definitions, what a heritage tree is, as well as what a significant tree is. 21A35 is where the interim regulations currently exist. So those apply citywide except for the town center. And then in the town center code, 21B, there's a separate set of tree retention regulations just for the town center. Okay, the emergency ordinance that City Council adopted on October 14th. The next few slides will cover the primary components of that ordinance. There were six of them. The first two are shown here on this slide. So the first thing that the ordinance does is that it retained the existing 25% significant tree retention requirement, but limited that provision to just new short plats of two lots. The second bullet on this slide then covers the rest of it, which is the significant tree retention requirement was raised from 25% to 35% for new subdivisions and short plats of three or more lots. So the provisions only changed for new subdivisions and short plats of three or more lots. It does not affect, for example, commercial development. It's only focused on subdivisions and short plats. Oops. Okay. Next provision in the interim regulations, the what's referred to as the double count of significant trees in environmentally sensitive areas, which can be used as a credit towards the base tree retention requirement for subdivisions and short plats, that was eliminated in the interim regulations. Up to 50% of the significant tree requirement could be credited in environmentally sensitive areas. So that no longer exists. There were a couple of bonuses in the old regulations that were eliminated. The primary reason why these were eliminated, you'll recall raising the retention percentage from 25 to 35%. Both of these had a percentage qualifier of 30 and 35% for reduced rec space requirements as well as increased net density of the site. So those have been removed in the interim regulations. A replanting requirement was introduced, a one-to-one ratio, requiring the replanting of every significant tree that was lawfully removed as part of a development application under the interim regulations. So now that's in code. And then finally, the size of a deciduous tree being used for replanting, the size requirement was increased from 1.5 inch diameter to 2.5 inch diameter. Council, City Council had discussed at a couple of different points an interest in species diversity, and I'll touch on that a little bit later here in this presentation as well. The next couple of slides were presented to City Council just as a very small sampling of both native deciduous trees as well as the next slide, native conifers, and just to show maturity height based on research we did, as well as potential canopy area that each tree could cover at full maturity. So you'll see a sampling here of the deciduous trees, next slide, conifers. And one of the things that we are working on per council direction is a much fuller native tree species list with similar type information. Okay, the next couple slides. This slide here is a summary, the same slide that we showed City Council. As we were preparing for October 14th, part of our work was to go back and look at subdivisions that were already vested and had moved either partially or all the way through the plat approval process. And we wanted to just look backwards and do an analysis of the interim regulations that were being proposed, how they would have applied to already vested projects. So I'm actually gonna, on the next couple slides, walk you through the Penny Lane example, but what I'd like to do is just walk you through this table to show you how it works. So you've got four subdivisions across the top. You'll see the acreage and the number of lots that were proposed in each of those. Now the six rows going down, we'll just briefly walk through each one. So the first row, the 25% retention amount, that's under the old code. They were required to submit a tree retention plan with 25% retention. So the next row down, row number two, that's essentially in three of the four examples, you'll see that there were trees then that were able to be credited in that 50% credit towards environmentally sensitive areas. So half of 14 trees in the Penny Lane example, seven of those then could be retained in the critical area. The Stuart Porter example did not have any critical areas, so all the significant trees, the 25%, had to be retained anywhere on the site. The third row down then is the new standard requirement of 35% retention. So you'll see what those numbers are there. The fourth row down identifies the number of trees that are required under the new one-to-one ratio replanting requirement. So the numbers across in that row simply represent the total number of significant trees on site outside of the any critical areas minus the 35% that has to be retained. The fifth row down, additional trees retained, that represents row number three, which is the 35% retention amount, minus the first row, which is the difference between the 25 and 35%. And then finally, the bottom line, which is the sixth row, is the difference between the 35% retention amount and the actual number of trees that they would have had to actually retain outside of the critical areas under the old code, which is row number two. So in the Penny Lane example, the 19 trees minus seven, 12 additional trees were being retained on site outside of the critical area. Okay, and then this is the actual Penny Lane subdivision. So what we have here is, I'll start with the area highlighted in blue. That's the actual delineated critical area. The areas highlighted in orange in the top right corner, as well as then the proposed lots and the cul-de-sac, that's the non-critical area. So this is the application of the former code. You'll recall, as we just looked at, there were, under the old code, 25% retention was a retention requirement of 14 trees. So what we've highlighted here in green is just, and again, this was just a random sampling to get to 14, but 50% of the 14 trees were able to be retained inside a count inside a critical area. So we've highlighted seven of those in blue, in the blue area. And then we highlighted seven significant trees in the orange area, and all of which on this example are in the top right corner. So now this is application of the interim regulations. With the 35% retention requirement, there were 19 trees required to be retained. None of those could be credited towards being in a critical area or the area in blue in this example. So again, what we did was we went through and highlighted 19 trees in green, all of which have to be in the orange area. I think 12 of them were in the top right corner, and then seven of them, a couple on the left-hand side of the screen, and then some on the right-hand side, lower right-hand side of the screen are highlighted there to get to 19. So I'll just flash back. 14 trees have to be accounted for being retained, 50% of them in the critical area under the former regulations. With the interim regulations, 19 trees in this example, all of them outside of the critical area. Okay, I guess the final thing I would say actually about the interim regulations, as was pointed out by a number of people who spoke during public comment, the evening that the council considered the emergency ordinance with the interim regulations, the application of the interim regulations will vary widely on a site-by-site, case-by-case basis, depending on a number of variables, where the trees are located on site, size of potential critical areas on a site, topography on the site, road connections, and so forth. So it's there's clearly no set recipe or protocol to follow to say same impacts will apply to any site with the interim regulations. They're all going to be different. So, and again, as we told council, this is just one example. We could have selected any number of examples and would have had very, very wide results in terms of what the impacts would look like.
Hey, Jeff, just a quick question.
Yep.
Can you go back to that for a second? I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but looking at the trees that you highlighted to be saved, those bigger circles, those are drip lines in the upper right-hand corner?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this is just, I'm going to be picky for a second. I'm looking at some of the trees on the lots that were picked. Some of those drip lines, you know, could potentially impact being able to site a house, but it looks like maybe there was a tract, kind of if you extended, instead of the cul-de-sac, like a half street. See what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Right there.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe that could have been used for tree retention.
It could have. There was no exact science going into highlighting the seven trees out in that area, but identifying significant trees that would have worked best for the proposal.
Is that the conclusion of the presentation?
No.
Are you done? No?
No, we're just getting started.
I was going to say, yeah.
We're about halfway done, actually. But we are moving on in subject matter to a summary of the City Council direction from a couple of work sessions. So maybe this might be a good time to pause, and if there's any additional questions regarding the interim regulations, we can try and answer those now for you.
Jeff, what's the duration for the interim regulation? Is it until we come up with the permanent regulation?
So the emergency ordinance is good for 6 months. As I'll touch on later near the end of the presentation, council is required to have a public hearing on the emergency ordinance. They do have that scheduled at this point. After 6 months, action will be required in some form. That could be on or before 6 months. Either the interim regulations can be extended, they can be modified, or they can simply expire if permanent regulations are adopted before the first 6 months.
I have lots of questions, and that's why I was asking if it was our turn yet. I will take this opportunity to ask one. We were going to have policy of keeping a parking lot board available and a person manning it. Why don't we have that?
I think that's, and I've already forgotten your name. I'm so sorry.
This is Mike.
Mike.
Yes.
And we can certainly, if there's...
We as a panel decided to have a parking lot that people would write on, that it's been removed. I think we should have it here. Tree retention's a big deal. And our comments, in my opinion, and the public's comments and staff's comments should from time to time be listed on a parking lot.
Okay.
And it should be on public display for the rest of the audience.
I think tonight, and correct me if I'm wrong, Jeff, but tonight is a brainstorm, and we will come up with this list.
That's an example of why you want a board. All brainstorming should have a board.
Okay. Can we get a board?
Yeah, I think the board was something that was being used for the comp plan discussions along the way. But we can certainly, the intent of tonight actually was to get the commission caught up on the interim regulations, and then just to do a review of some existing material already. But for future work sessions on tree retention, we can certainly bring the parking lot board back and have that available for the commission to have different notes and ideas posted up there. So, yeah, it's great. Any other questions on the interim regulations at this point? Nope. We'll certainly be able to go back if additional questions arise. So.
Do you really want to take questions, or do you want to get done with your presentation? My first one is...
Is this on the interim regulations?
Yeah. We're not doing any performance standards in our interim regulations. All we're doing is changing a couple numbers and a couple sequences. The real performance standard we're trying to address here is how are trees impacting the city of Sammamish, and will changing the regulations to put them all the way back at this development also going to change the impact on how it affects the everyday Sammamish citizen? I think we're way beyond that as far as what needs to happen, and I think we need to brainstorm and write them on a parking lot as far as ideas about how to encapsulate and make it so that the citizens and their interests and the city's interests are better served. There's a code, and I understand how staff has to comply with code, but there's other mechanisms that can make it so that the end result is functional. Performance standards is one of them. One of the ways that City of Sammamish does that is by a citizen development committee, where it's a group of people that look at significant developments and say, how is that going to change the character of Sammamish, and how can we mitigate that and still make it profitable for the developer? Putting all the trees on the back corner of a property so that they can develop the front and change the character of the city is probably not the best way to be able to get that performance standard. having citizens that live in the city to actually look at it and comment it on ahead of time is probably one of the ways to accomplish that. I'm after performance standards.
So, Commissioner Collins, you raise a number of good points. The emergency ordinance, staff was directed by council to prepare the emergency ordinance and bring that forward. The intent of the emergency ordinance was to strengthen the regulatory requirements while everything that you just summarized in your statement ensues and takes place during a full legislative review process. So what we're starting here tonight with a summary of some of this information is exactly much of what you just suggested in your statement.
That's why I was asking. So we're going to have
that. We're going to have that discussion about future meetings here at the end of the presentation. So, okay. Next couple slides provide a summary of City Council direction. We covered this at the joint City Council Planning Commission session that some of you were able to attend on September 9th this year. So there was some direction that came out of that meeting from City Council's discussion with the commission, and then there was also, as I understand it, December 2013 work session with City Council is where the core of the initial direction came from. So there's 10 items here that I'll move through. I think most of these you're already familiar with. Council had an interest at the time, back in December 2013, of increasing tree retention. 30% was suggested at the time, with some other qualifiers. In December 2013, council also talked about developing incentives for tree retention over and above the minimum requirements. Item three up here, establishing species lists for both retention and replanting, and some discussion about prioritization. Existing lots of record are not currently addressed in city code for tree retention. So council expressed an interest in developing some regulations for that. Replanting is mentioned a couple times. In this case, it was discussed in December of 2013 in regards to any land clearing activities. You'll see on this slide here again, item number five, establishing limitations on trees removed, again, on existing lots of record, and establishing a fees for permits to do such. Item number six is one that council's had quite a bit of discussion about, and that's penalties for illegal tree removals. Designing developments around trees, we've had some discussion about. I think there was some discussion about that at your joint session on September 9th with the council. And then this is getting into our critical areas code a little bit, but talking about erosion hazard areas, further protection of those, but also increasing planting in those areas and identifying opportunities for that. Tree canopy. Increasing tree canopy and also getting back to those tree lists, achieving that using an array of different native species. More recently, council's also had some discussion about appropriate non-native species, and we're doing some research on that. And then lastly, item number 10, giving some consideration towards public open space area plantings, kind of getting back to the erosion hazard area item in number eight. But we've taken a look so far at some different options, whether that be city initiated or possible offsite plantings from private development. There's some different mechanisms out there to achieve that. So council has had quite a bit of discussion on this. Those of you that were there on September 9th will recall that discussion that took place. This is a high-level summary of a lot of discussion they've had so far. Okay, The next couple slides address draft tree retention policies as part of your 2015 comp plan update work. This is not an exhaustive list. We will provide that to you in hard copy form. But there are some pretty specific policies that you've worked on already as both as part of the land use element on this slide. And I can run through these really quick. That element of design and designing around existing trees and native vegetation, flexibility, clustering, and then also the concept of restoration and replanting in LU 6.2. So that's a sampling of policies from the land use element. From the environmental element, there's some additional policies. Three of them are included here. We talk about protecting habitat and achieving that through tree retention in EC 4.9, the tree canopy, the preservation and enhancement of it in 9.1, and then again getting back to that public properties and other types of restricted areas to preserve and possibly do reforestation replanting opportunities as well in 9.2. Okay, at this point, I'd like Mike to, he's going to walk you through the Tree City USA program as well as what an ISA certified arborist is. So I'm going to turn it over to Mike and he'll walk you through the next few slides.
Thanks, Jeff. Okay, so the Tree City USA program is administered by the Arbor Day Foundation and it provides cities with the framework for community forestry management. There are 84 cities in Washington that are currently tree cities, and that includes Issaquah and Redmond. Tree city status is achieved by meeting four standards. The first is maintaining a tree board or department, and that must be run by a professional forester, an arborist, a volunteer tree board, or an entire department. Second, the city must have a public tree care ordinance, and a key section of that ordinance establishes the tree board or department and gives them the responsibility for public tree care. The third standard they must meet is to have a budget of at least $2 per capita on urban forestry, and that must be documented towards the planting, care, and removal of city trees. And the last and possibly easiest requirement is that they must celebrate Arbor Day, and that can be simple and brief, or it can be an all-day or all-week observation. So some of the benefits of becoming a tree city include improving the city's public image, which can help attract businesses. There are financial benefits. For example, tree cities are sometimes given preference for forestry grants. And there are also public education benefits, and this includes the promotion of information about tree care and conservation to a large number of residents. Okay, so for certified arborists, this is basically a voluntary credential given by the International Society of Arboriculture, the ISA. And to become a certified arborist, you must have a minimum of 3 years of full-time experience working in the professional tree care industry, or you can have a four-year degree in a related field and 1 year of practical experience. After that, you must complete the ISA's extensive examination covering 10 areas of knowledge. Some of those areas of knowledge include soil management, installation, urban forestry, and tree risk management, among others. And finally, membership must be maintained every 3 years through continuing education. So there's a code of ethics that certified arborists must follow. For example, they're required to disclose potential conflicts of interest and may only work when they're qualified for the job. And finally, certified arborists may earn additional certifications, such as a utility specialist or a municipal specialist. And these specializations require additional experience and testing over just the base certified arborist certification.
Quick question, Mike.
Yeah.
Assuming a city wanted to choose an arborist as their provider or their care for the
for the Tree City thing. Yeah. Could that be an contract employee, or would it have, do you know if it has to be a full-time employee, or how would that need to be handled? Do you know?
For the Tree City specifically?
Yeah.
I believe it can be contract, but are you?
I think it can be, actually. Okay. Yeah. We have to demonstrate the relationship exists. So.
Can it also be with an institution? For example, can we contract with the UW Forestry Department or something to fulfill those services? I assume over time the ground rules are going to change and the species lists are going to change, and the most current information we're always going to have is probably the UW around here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good question. That's something we can definitely follow up on. Okay, thanks, Mike. Mm-hmm. This is the last slide, kind of bringing us full circle here. Again, the information here tonight was a starting point to bring the commission up to speed on the different subject matter that we've covered. In terms of where we go from here, with the interim regulations, as I mentioned earlier, council is required to have a public hearing within 60 days of adopting an emergency ordinance. So it was adopted on October 14th. They had till mid-December. They do have that scheduled for December 2nd. And that will be an open record public hearing where folks can come and testify to the city council about the interim regulations specifically. In regards to where we continue with our process here, and maybe this relates to the work program calendar item that we always cover at the end of your meeting, we do have a couple meetings still here before the end of 2014, another meeting in November, and then as well as two in December. As is with the situation here this evening, the 20th and the 4th, the commission already has comprehensive plan, different elements of the comp plan, subject matter to still cover and discuss with transportation and capital facilities. So for the next couple meetings, we'll definitely be able to, at the end of those items, we can continue the discussion with tree retention. And then currently we have December 11th completely open and available to spend a full evening on the subject as well, so.
Okay. At which of those dates do you anticipate the public will be able to comment on tree retention?
Well, I think some of that depends when we start bringing forward actual material that is for our consideration. I do wonder about your question about outreach, and I think you and I spoke about this a little bit. What outreach has done, what outreach can we do to that effect?
So following up on, this predates my time here at the city, but following up on last December's discussion that the city council had and gave some direction to staff, staff did conduct some initial outreach in the spring of this year in regards to tree retention. We have a comment tracker that Debbie was kind enough to put together for us that captured all of the comments that we've received there, and I believe we're continuing to add to that as additional comments and letters come in and discussions are going to be taking place. So the discussion that we need to have here, this ties back to public involvement. I would recommend that next time we get together, presumably on the 20th, to at least spend some time on tree retention, we go back to Commissioner Collins' concept and have some global discussion about policy and objectives, which would be revisiting some of the work, good work that you've already done over the last several months, just to have a check-in on that. And then I think we can also then begin the discussion about different tools that are available that can go into a regulatory framework to consider and discuss and ultimately make some recommendations on at some point. But if we get started in that direction, I think that will allow the public an opportunity to continue to follow your work, and then perhaps on December 11th, we can set up a specific framework where the public can share their thoughts with you in a more fuller manner. And we can see where we're at that point on the calendar and make some decisions about where we go from there in terms of the work program with this.
And is that compatible with council's direction? I mean, in terms of timing, the expiration of this, and I sort of have a sense of is that council's moving quickly also on this in order to meet that 6-month timeline. We're moving on it. Is there a possibility that council is going to get out in front of us on this, or are they still looking to us before they move on their own direction with this? Like, where is this on council's calendar?
It isn't at this point.
Okay.
There is, as I described earlier, there is a 6-month period with the interim regulations in effect, and there are options at the end of that 6-month period. Okay. I think it's fair to say that council would like this work to move along and progress. What's important here, and I just to go back to Commissioner Collins one more time, what's important here is that council's also interested, and certainly the staff and the city manager, we're all interested, and mostly probably the public, in having the commission do good work and have a full discussion on it and make recommendations that are going to be comprehensive and well thought out and considered. So my recommendation would be let's begin that journey here and start having those discussions, and we'll do a check-in here in December to see how much progress we've made, what the conversations look like, and that will help us frame up the rest of the process. So we do have, the commission does have competing priorities at the moment with trying to finish its work on the comp plan as well, but instead of rushing something through and being hasty about it, let's begin that journey and do it right and see where it takes us here after a few meetings.
Good. Very much, Jeff. And I do want to repeat the comment that we're taking written comments all the time, and you can just address them to?
Can address them to the Planning Commission, can address them to me. They all go to Debbie eventually and go into the record, so.
One of the things that was done when we first started talking about this issue is someone, I believe it was Commissioner Luxemburg, asked how many current applications are affected by this. It's something we often ask in this group, is if we're going to do something, how many things are affected by this currently. Over time, I imagine that will change in regards to this particular set of regulations, and will we be updated on that as we go along also?
In regards to the interim regulations,
yes.
Currently?
Yeah.
I can update you on that right now. So since the interim regulations were adopted on October 14th, my understanding is we have had one subdivision application come in. Folks that were representing that application did speak during public comment on the night of the 14th to City Council. And they are working with staff currently on, they were very close to submitting right in and around the 14th, and actually, it was the Water and Sewer District, and the unavailability of staff, I think, perhaps may have delayed their application a little bit in having their certificates issued. So we're working with them. They're looking to the city to have us work with them a little bit on their application. They are in a, talk about examples where there's different impacts on different types of proposals, just depending on the individual characteristics and variables in play with each one. They definitely do have some impact to what they had planned on submitting in terms of their proposal, so we're spending some time reviewing that with them right now and see what we can do for them. So,
thank you.
So looking ahead, Jeff, and kind of starting to merge into our work program calendar, I'm kind of curious about what staff thinks they'll be able to provide for us in advance of our 20th meeting, and kind of which
how do you see that discussion unfolding?
Yeah, so my understanding from Emily and Robin and folks working on the comp plan update, that the 20th, your discussion with the capital facilities element will be a fairly full discussion. So we may be in well into the perhaps the 8 o'clock hour before your work on that wraps up on the 20th. So what I would again recommend is we move to the 20th and plan on at least having a short discussion about at the goal and policy level, and perhaps then have a short series of just thoughts from the commission on brainstorming a little bit, and we'll take some notes and put them in the parking lot, and then that will help us then prepare for the 4th, where then we can introduce some of the different regulatory tools and so forth, and do a short briefing on those for you. And again, I think maybe have some more work session brainstorming style and seeing how all this is starting to fit together for you a little bit. And then we can talk about the 11th, having some public input on the 11th and some more discussion. So,
okay.
If the commission would like to do anything different, we're certainly open to. I'm a little concerned just about from a time constraint perspective over the next few meetings and making sure that the capital facility and transportation elements are also given the time they need by the commission for your question and answers and so forth with those folks. So,
okay. Good. And then it looks like, unless there's any kind of given layover from any of the comp plan stuff, we'll probably have a pretty hearty session on tree retention then on December 11th.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Good. Any other comments or questions on the work program calendar? Okay.
I have a question. It's sort of a burning question about tree retention that I think is pretty salient. I'm not really clear on what we're doing right now, so I'm not sure if I'm allowed to ask this question, but I think it's, and if Mike Luxenberg were here, he'd probably be saying the same thing. I don't quite understand what we're solving for. I know that what we're reacting to and what we're, and so if you go back and you look at council's 10 direction, nowhere in there does it say what the overall objectives are. And that's what I'm a little bit confused about. What are the objectives? What are we solving for? And secondly, when we have that discussion, we have to acknowledge the competing objectives, because and especially how we just finished a whole thing about transportation and compact development so that you can have density, so that you can, you know, not get, you know, and this is a 20-year plan, right? And so, well, no, I'm sorry, that's a comprehensive plan, but you can't have a tree retention ordinance that competes with that in the core of the city. So mm-hmm. I feel like I'm not a tree expert. I have no idea what the number should be. I don't want to talk about that. I want to talk about what we're solving for. Mm-hmm. And the character is really, really important, but what does that mean? And where does that differ? And how does that affect all the other goals that everybody, not just council, not just commission, but citizens, have stated over and over again about walkability and about connectedness and about all these other, you know, mixed use and all those other things. And we have to, so I think we have to make sure we understand the objectives, what we're solving for, and acknowledge the competing objectives so that we can then have a framework to have a good discussion.
And I think what Jeff alluded to earlier on the 20th is starting to outline some of those objectives, going back and looking at some of the specific tree retention policies we talked about before, maybe fleshing those out a little bit. We had even acknowledged that during those discussions, knowing that we were going to come to this juncture and, you know, kind of fleshing it all out together.
In my opinion, there's two things going on. One is to implement the interim emergency legislation and confirm that we've talked about it and send that on so that they can perhaps put that into code.
Is that being put in front of us? I guess
well, you saw the text in your packet, so that appears like it's in front of us.
But that
I thought that was just FYI.
Jeff, can you address
actually,
that?
Actually, I saw it as the pointing direction as far as how the discretion is currently tracked. However, comma, I think that the Planning Commission can direct staff and can ask staff to do a more comprehensive
review of tree retention, and what is the performance standard? What are we trying to solve for, just like you said, and actually get some testimony and be able to deliver that to the council so that it represents more of what the citizens of Sammamish actually feel. What's the look and feel of Seattle, of Sammamish, and how does it function?
I would agree with Commissioner Collins on his second point, that is the objective of council, is to go through and do a comprehensive look at. Council's heard from many, many constituents at this point, both through public comment, both through written comments that have been sent to them, and I'm sure both through receiving emails and phone calls on an individual basis. There are a lot of people concerned, and all seven council members currently agree at this point about the loss of significant trees in the community from development activities. So the emergency ordinance, what I would not agree with Commissioner Collins on was his first point, which was council has any sort of preconceived expectation that the provisions of the interim regulations are the regulations that they're looking for the Planning Commission to forward a recommendation on. I think there's an opportunity here for the commission, again, using the word comprehensive, to go back and take a look at everything is on the table, to go back, take a look, have discussion, have those work sessions, and ultimately have staff craft some regulations at your direction, bring them forward, have a public hearing, and make a recommendation on those to the city council. The interim regulations in the emergency ordinance are just that. They were viewed as a change in as a starting point to address the problem that council has concluded at this point they'd like to see us do some work on. So
I think you spoke very well on it. The one thing I'd like to comment on, though, is it's not what the council feels, it's the citizens of Sammamish and what they feel about it.
Yeah.
And council is only reacting to the citizens. So it's the citizens that I'm concerned about trying to do a good job for.
And ultimately, from a staff perspective, we need to craft some code that I think at least one of you mentioned competing interests and balancing competing interests.
Not even just competing interests. I just want to be really clear on this. We're not talking about, I'm not even talking about the classic property rights versus environment argument. I'm talking about competing environmental objectives and competing land use objectives and competing community objectives. Yep. So let's just be clear. And I think they need to be acknowledged, because we, in order to do what the citizens want, the citizens are asking for lots of things, and they don't ask for them at the same time, and sometimes they're in competition. And that's all I'm saying is what we have to have a decision. I understand the process questions. Those weren't my questions. I don't know if you're directing the response to me. My question is more about framing the discussion about what we're trying to solve.
And also, I would ask that the scope of it, you know, like I made a note here that the relationship between other elements that we're looking at, for example, like shoreline and things like that, there is a relationship between trees and shoreline that is can't be ignored, in my opinion. And I think that that's something that if we're going to discuss, I'd like to hear some technical discussion of that, some review of that, so that we're making things in that context of a broader context, if it is competing or whatever it is. That we understand that and what we're being asked to do. Because I think that the numbers that were thrown out in the emergency ordinance, a lot of them, I'm asking, why that number, right? Why 35%, mm-hmm. You know? Why not 50%? Why not 20%? You know, it's like, why was 35, if 35 is our target? I don't know. I mean, it's like, what are we doing there? So.
And even why the inch and a half versus the 2-inch on the trees. I'm not an expert, and I hope you will be giving us experts. I've been told in the past by staff that the inch and a half caliper
forms the root ball better and provides a better overall finished product and more lasting product than the 2.5. So, I mean, we need specifics.
Mm-hmm. Just not tonight.
That's fine.
I think we have heard about competing interest, but I wanted to see some staff research. Are there really competing interest? I think we are making assumptions that competing interest, citizens are asking for too many things and they're competing with each other. I do think there is probably a sweet spot with respect to retaining some level of trees and allowing some level of growth. But I do like to hear from your standpoint with some research, what is that sweet spot? Mm-hmm. And that goes back to those numbers, 25%, 35%. What is that sweet spot at which point we can allow the growth that we need to allow and still able to keep character of Sammamish? I think it's too quick for me to say it's a competing interest unless I see that research.
I think that's a nice way of framing it, actually. I also believe some of the discussion that the commission is going to want to have is about prioritization as well, and not just prioritization between the different components that go into making a city or the different components that go into a site-by-site analysis, but within the framework of regulation themselves, what's more important to protect and regulate, preserve than others. So I think we'll get there.
All right. Do you have a short, brief director's report?
Yeah, well, just one thing, and she's getting tired of hearing about it at this point, but we did have an award-winning planner recognized at the State American Planning Association Conference in Spokane a couple weeks ago. Robin received the Barbara Grace Award for her dedication to the profession and to public service. And she was really surprised when she received the award because many people managed to keep a lid on it and not tip her off that she was going to be winning it. So she looked really surprised when she got up there on stage. But it was wonderful to see one of our own recognized on a statewide basis. It's a really big deal. There were several hundred people there at the conference and at the award luncheon when it happened. And City Council also honored Robin with we kind of reenacted the presentation on Monday night for Council up at the podium. Joe Tovar, who I think some of you probably know, representing the Washington State APA chapter, was kind enough to come up on Monday night and on behalf of the chapter and make a little spiel for Robin and have a photo op and so forth. So we're extremely proud of her. She's doing really good work for us, and just wanted to talk about that a little bit here with the Planning Commission.
Good, so congratulations.
Yeah, well deserved.
But no cake tonight. Sorry.
There's good cookies over there. Yes.
Yeah. That's it. Yep. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
All in favor of adjourning? Aye. Any opposed? And we are adjourned at 8:52.